Again, welcome back. Make sure you give us a call if you have any questions. I'm sure you have some for our mayor this evening. How'd the meeting go?
The meeting went fairly well, I thought. It's always good to keep them under an hour, so we did manage to stick to that schedule. We had a pretty healthy discussion about the Renaissance Zone tax exemption for Metro Plains. They're planning on doing a 24-unit affordable senior housing project on the former Essentia Clinic site, and so they had asked for a 100% property tax exemption for that project that they're developing, and that would be a five-year tax exemption for them. It did pass 3-1. Councilman Brubachin was absent tonight, and Councilman Buchanan voted against it. So we had a fairly healthy discussion about that first.
And that is part of, that's one of the options for the Renaissance Zone.
That's correct. In fact, one of the main purposes of the Renaissance Zone was to revitalize underutilized or blighted properties, particularly in downtown areas. And this is now a vacant building that contains a lot of obstacles to development. It has a lot of asbestos in it that requires a lot of abatement in order for it to be developed. And the Renaissance Zone would love to see commercial development, but also residential, because that is what brings the vitality to a downtown area, is to have that residential development. And so it's very exciting to see this project come in that's going to be housing in the downtown area, also repurposing this clinic site, taking care of a hazardous problem and the asbestos in that area, as well as providing a needed housing project. We are short a lot of housing in Jamestown, particularly for vulnerable populations. So elderly, those that are in an income bracket that's less than the median income, those kinds of things are the populations that we want to make sure that they have affordable housing and that we're accommodating that in our city so that we're attracting development to our area. So we're very excited to see that project move forward, and they will be fully on the tax rolls after 5 years, which is also exciting because that's going to be a good investment into our downtown.
We look at that building and it looks so nice. We forget that it's was built when it was. It's not as new as it looks.
You know, I think it was maintained very well as a building by the clinics that occupied that site. And because it was utilized recently as a clinic, I think we underestimate the number of obstacles that are to developing that site into anything but demolishing that site and then rebuilding on it. So they have a really good plan for this. There's not a guarantee that they're going to move forward. Everything is pretty much contingent upon their financing, so they have a lot of other hurdles they need to get through. And this is one of those pieces that makes that project happen for Jamestown so that we continue to add to our affordable housing for senior populations.
Thank you, Mary Anderson. We'll be back with you in just a couple minutes. Right now I want to talk to Rayette Brown, who's here to talk about
the Heart Redneck Triathlon.
The Heart Redneck Triathlon that's coming up. So it's actually this coming Saturday,
correct?
It's coming
Saturday. It came up fast. But
and
I'm
it's
really
at the
excited.
Buffalo Lanes.
It's at the Buffalo Lanes and the Buffalo Bar.
Okay. Well, let's talk a little bit about how it got started, Rayette.
Last year, I always wanted to do a heart vent in Jamestown, and I just couldn't come up with the right. You know, I've tried the heart walks and stuff, and Jamestown, like, seems to me like they have, like, the funner events. So a couple friends of mine came up with the idea to come, we should do a triathlon instead of a, you know, a fitness triathlon. Let's do a fun triathlon. So last year we did bowling, pool, and darts, and we came up with 14 teams, which was great the first year, because last year I scheduled it the same day as the Rural Fire Department fishing tournament. Well, everybody was there. So we had a great team and a great time, and everybody's like, you got to do it again, you got to do it again, this is great, you know. And all the proceeds went back to HART, you know, so it's
which they're going to this year as well.
Right, exactly.
And do you have lots of teams signed up already?
So far I got 10 so far, so I think a lot of them are just going to show up Saturday, and, you know, which is great too.
Go ahead.
And it's teams of three or individual. I mean, it's more fun if you get a team together, of course, but
and it's bowling?
Bowling, pool darts. I added three more events.
Which are?
We're doing canoeing, a washer toss, and a hut hike.
You're doing canoeing?
Canoeing. They're going to be actually sitting on a skateboard, and they're going to toilet plunge themselves to the fall line or the end line. So I hear it's really good. I hear it's fun. So we're going to try it.
Okay,
you know?
And what else are you doing?
Hut hike is, I have a hula hoop that's 15 feet away, so everybody gets to do 10 rolls of toilet paper. They're going to hike them. They're going to hike them between their legs and try to get them through the hoop. They'll get so many points per toilt paper roll.
And of course, how much ice? Oh, let's not go there right this minute.
You know.
We could,
yeah.
But I think maybe we'd be best not to.
Yeah,
okay.
Probably.
And the last, the other one.
And the washer toss. You know, like a beanbag toss? Mm-hmm. We're doing the washers. It's kind of like a redneck horseshoe.
Got
game,
it.
So.
Okay. Yeah. It sounds like lots of fun. So registration starts at noon.
Registration starts at noon. And also at noon, I got the Jamestown College nursing students coming down to do hands-on CPR demonstrations.
Great.
And blood pressures, you know, that's all heart-related.
Mm-hmm.
And also, Mrs. North Dakota America, Allie Downs, is coming in from Bismarck to come in for autograph and picture session and to help out. So and I'm really excited to have Allie coming in Jamestown.
And the event runs from 1 until 4?
1 to 4, and we're having also a silent auction. We had that last year, and that went very well, and people were very generous in giving, and we're going to do that again. The proceeds all benefit HEART. I have this project called Get Her Done Hearts, which is part of my local support network that I do once a month. And through that, my Get Her Done program, I give back to the HEART programs that educate women to live longer and healthier lives. I'm also, with my heart support group, I do the heart awareness, the facts, the symptoms and stuff through the monthly support. And also this year, if men and women or individuals, if they're having intense treatments being done like Fargo or Bismarck, you know, if they bring proof to me that they need a little donation, small donation to me, like bringing the heart, their doctor slip or something. Mm-hmm. I'll take it up with my board and I'll be able to give them back. It's my way of kind of giving back to the community to help them out.
Gas
with
money.
A small. Right. Gas money motel. Good mm-hmm. example. I had heart surgery last Thursday called the ablation. So I had to go down Wednesday. I had to come back. I had to go down Thursday again. And then I got to go back and do checkups and stuff, but
okay.
So well, I'm really excited.
It sounds like it's going to be so much fun.
It will. I encourage people to come down. They can come down and register.
Watch.
It's teams of three, $45, or individual 15. Mm-hmm. It averages out to be 15 a piece. So it's a good fun, you know, small amount donation. Like I said, everything goes back to HEART. Mm-hmm. I don't get any of it. I have a separate account set up at First Community Credit Union under HEART Redneck Triathlon. Everything goes in there. And
so if anybody has any questions, they can call you. What
they
number?
Can call me at 320-2023, or they can email me at rays, womenheart@yahoo.com. But it's easier to get a hold of me. 320-2023.
Okay. Well, thank you so much, Rayette, for being here.
Right, thanks
and
for
a
having
great
me
time
again.
This Saturday.
Thank
it sounds
you.
Like lots of fun.
All right. Thank
okay,
you.
Okay. Mayor, we have a couple questions here.
Okay.
Do you know when Sky West will start serving Jamestown?
Sure. That's a great topic to talk about. Sky West was awarded the contract for the Federal Department of Transportation to serve as the airline for our area now. As you may have read in the paper, Great Lakes pulled out of their contract to serve us earlier than they were anticipated. They actually finished service last Friday, and that's unfortunate because we're going to have a gap in airline service to Jamestown, but we're very excited to have SkyWest coming. They are going to be here as soon as possible, but they have a lot of allocation of resources to take care of. We anticipate that they will be able to start by the first week of June, maybe sooner. And so SkyWest is a great regional carrier. They're going to have a full code share with United. We're going to have 11 flights weekly that'll go into Denver, and with a 50-passenger CRJ airplane, it's got a bathroom on board, an attendant, and it's going to be a great flight. It's about an hour and 15 minutes from here to
and
Denver.
And soda?
I don't know if there's soda. It might be a bring-your-own kind of beverage type flight, but we are very excited that we're going to be capturing this market here with a great regional carrier. I know that there's a lot of the Minneapolis destination that's very disappointed in that we're going to Denver, but actually 70% of the flights that go out of North Dakota go west. And so heading towards the western direction is great. It's a great connection down into Phoenix where we have a lot of travelers from Jamestown that go. And you'll be able to book through your travel agent. You'll be able to book online. Travelocity, anything like that will be a very clear connection, unlike what we've had in the past. And you'll be able to acquire and use SkyMiles through United as well.
Oh, that's great. Okay. And again, you said you think
June is the date that they are willing to say publicly. However, we're working with them to make sure that we could get service here as soon as possible. But it's an allocation of a lot of resources right. for them to serve this market.
Okay. I thought the contracts was actually for April, and that's why I was questioning.
Right. But they have a period of time that they have for transitioning. And so we're hoping that they'll be here sooner than that. But okay. I know they're willing to say April or to June out loud.
Okay. The next question, why did the city announce that residential areas would be cleaned of snow January 28th, I think it says here, Tuesday, when they started on Monday the 27th and plowed vehicles in on the street?
Well, I guess I'm not sure what that public service. I get all the public service announcements, however, I don't necessarily look into them.
I'll let you take that one.
I'll
it
take
doesn't
it with
have
it.
A phone number on it. If the person who wrote this calls back and gives us a phone number, the mayor will call
we
you.
We can follow up. Yep, exactly. And I'll make sure we talk to the Public Works Department. They're usually actually really good about coordinating the public service announcements with what they are actually practicing.
Okay. Our next guests up are Eileen Lisko and Diane Witzig, who are here to talk about the Jamestown Area Grief Support System. And I'm glad you're back because we've got another wonderful event to talk about.
Thanks. We're always happy to be here and we appreciate the opportunity to let the community know what we're up to.
Okay. Well, let's talk.
Well, we have a program coming up. We annually, usually in February, we do a program that's called Soup for the Soul. And with all the cold weather we have been having, it's a great night to come and warm up with a little soup. We will be serving a meal of soup and sandwiches at our program.
And dessert.
And dessert.
Oh, dessert.
Most important part.
No, I have to say, you know, Diane, you've come enough times to understand the concept of dessert in this show. So I appreciate the fact that you brought that up.
The important part.
The important part, yes. Mm-hmm.
And our topic at this evening's program is supporting grieving children. And children kind of tend to be a group that get lost in the shuffle of grieving. I think sometimes people don't understand that children grieve as much as adults do. They often don't show their feelings, or a lot of times the kind of behaviors that they're exhibiting might be, people might think it's something else bothering them. They don't understand that that if they've experienced the loss of somebody important to them, they are going to grieve that loss, and it's maybe harder for children because their peers, it's less likely that their peers will have had a similar experience. As people get into a certain age level, those that have lost parents or lost spouses, you know, may know others who've had that same experience. But for children, those losses are a little less common, and so they don't often feel they have someone to turn to. And Diane Croston, who's probably very well known to most of your viewers, a counselor in the Jamestown Public School System for many, many years as our speaker. She has a wealth of experience. She's just going to do an awesome job, I think, for us on
well, anybody
this
who knows
topic.
Diane knows that she will.
Right, right. And, you know, so we really are encouraging any, the program's not for children. It's for adults who are working with children. So whether it's a parent, a grandparent, or someone who knows a child who's had a loss, or teachers, daycare providers, clergy.
Let me ask you a real quick question, too, actually. Mm-hmm. When do you think it is that children actually sort of start making that transition out of child grieving to more adult grieving? Is it, you know, 14, 15? Are
well,
we talking?
I suppose it depends on the maturity of the child mm-hmm. and also the type of loss. You know, a child who has lost a parent may be put into a more a role of taking on more responsibility. So they're going to probably transition into an adult mentality a little quicker than a child, mm-hmm. you know, a younger child who hasn't had that experience. And, you know, I think the type of loss has a lot to do with it. Children who lose a sibling, or, you know, that's going to be a totally different experience than someone who loses a parent or a close friend.
Or a grandparent.
Or a grandparent, mm-hmm. right. Yeah.
It depends on the relationship with the grandparent.
Exactly. Yeah. And many children are... Some children are closer to their grandparents than to their parents. Mm-hmm. And for other children, it's a grandparent that lives in another state. They maybe see them once a year. That's a whole different kind of relationship. But children who are very close to their grandparents, that's a huge loss for them. I think any person who is a big part of their life, who dies, and if it's a young, you know, if it's a sibling or a classmate, a friend, those are such unexpected things. Mm-hmm. You know, we don't ever anticipate losing a child. And sometimes if it affects the whole family, the parents are also grieving. They really just don't have the energy to be able to help their child through the grieving experience because they're grieving themselves. So it's a very hard situation. We've also noticed in the past, sometimes when we've worked with children, if it's something that has affected the whole family, children sometimes try to hide their own feelings to protect their parents. They see that the parents are upset. They may have seen mom or dad cry for the first time in their life, and they think, if I cry, if I tell them how I'm feeling, they're going to cry again. It's going to make it worse. Mm-hmm. And I'm, of course, the parents wouldn't feel that way, but children don't understand that. And so it's a really, they're sometimes really a kind of a lost population, right. as far mm-hmm. as grief. And so we really want to give the caring adults in their life some tools, some, you know, ideas of how to help those children get through that experience.
Okay. And Diane, where is this going to be held?
It's going to be at the Women's Club Room. That's located right behind Otmar and Otmar.
Okay,
and it's going to be Tuesday, next a week from tomorrow, at 6:30 p.m. And like Eileen said, there's wonderful, there's a catered meal. TJ's on their wonderful homemade buns and making sandwiches and soup and dessert. It should be a really fun evening. Mm-hmm. To follow up with a little bit on what Eileen was talking about, we lost a daughter, and we had three other children. And our youngest one was only 5 at the time. And they do it, I mean, they react differently. It was maybe a whole year before he really came around. We had family counseling and so on. And that's why I think Diane is just going to be wonderful.
I think she is, too. It'll be a fantastic evening. Mm-hmm. Well, good. Thank you both for coming. And I hope a lot of people show up. Hope you run out of soup.
Yeah, that'd be great.
Just don't run out of dessert.
Yeah.
Save some for you. Save some for me. Exactly, exactly. Cut yours in half or something. Okay.
I'll cut yours in half.
Oh, okay, there you go. Thank you so much,
thanks.
Both of you, for coming. Come back again soon.
We will. Okay. Thank you.
So, Mayor Anderson, let's talk a little bit more about the meeting. What else went on?
The balance of the meeting was actually fairly regular, I guess. We did talk about the design for the water tower and whether we are going to be approving a change order to provide us with a little more appealing paint scheme. Councilman Buchanan kept saying it's designer, and so I kept thinking of, like, you know, Louis Vuitton water tower or something like that. But anyways, it's not that type of designer, but it is a very nice, classy design, but it does cost a little more money, and so we need to make a decision about that. We're going to talk about it again on our public works agenda, but we spent probably a lot more time discussing the paint scheme for the water tower than any other item on the agenda.
It's pretty funny that you're actually talking about the paint scheme, considering we're going to be talking about designer purses in just a moment.
I had a premonition about this designer thing.
Exactly. Okay. What does this design look like that you said that is?
The design is based on kind of a blue paint scheme. It's different shades of blue. It's all circular, and then it says Jamestown, North Dakota in white letters. It's very, I don't know, I think it's very classy and very modern looking, and I think it projects the right image for our city, which is we want to be able to say this is a place where you can grow. You can grow your family, you can grow your business here, and having the right image on your water tower, I think, projects that. And it's probably not the highest priority on the things that we need to be spending dollars on, but it is a great marketing tool, and it's one of the first things people see from this when they drive into the city, either on 281 or on I-94. They'll see this water tower, and it's visible from almost every location in town. You can see it as you're driving down Hospital Hill, used to be Hospital Hill, but the hospital was still located there. You can actually see it when you're out on the reservoir.
And we still call it Mill Hill, and when was the last time we had a mill? I mean,
Anyways, it's a very visible structure in our town, mm-hmm. and I wanted to make sure it's projected the right image. So I think they've done a great job with the design. Red Plum did the design for us, and they came up with a great concept, and we just need to finalize it at the city council level for funding and approval.
And I think when people go other places, they do notice the water towers. Mm-hmm. And we may not think about it for ourselves, but when we go someplace, great water tower. Okay. Our next guests are Shelley Nanigay and Carmel Wanzik, who are talking about the Wounded Warrior Purses for a Purpose. And again, we're talking, did you bring a Louis Vuitton with you?
I brought a Prada.
Oh, that's good. Very lovely.
And one of the coach purses that we've had donated.
Fantastic.
We did bring four bags, but we couldn't bring them in.
Yes. We brought bags of purses to show, but
bags. It's actually pretty funny because when I was coming down the hall, I'm going, ooh, look at these bags. Ooh, these are bags of bags.
So fun.
Are we taking them in? And I kept thinking, why aren't they? Well, obviously, because we couldn't get them all in here.
Sure.
And
they would cover the table.
They would. They were fabulous. And so this is a great project. This is an absolutely great project that they're doing. So great that I actually made them come back.
Yes.
Because I first bought, I didn't buy the VIP ticket to start with, because I'm not really a bag person. However, the person I was inviting to come with me is a bag person, so I made him come back and trade tickets, so I now had to pay a little bit more to get the VIP, but I think it's going to be well worth it. So now that I've got whetted everybody's appetite, they're going to tell you what the VIP ticket is. So let's talk about purses for a purpose. Yes.
There we go. And I'm going to let Carmel Wanzik talk about it because it's really her project. So go ahead, Carmel.
Well, the project started with I'm taking a Dale Carnegie class, mm-hmm. and we wanted to do a pay it forward project. And so what a better people to pay it forward to but our veterans that have given so much to us. So I wanted to find a way that we could pay it for the invisible wounds, not the obvious ones. So I contacted Shelley Nanigay at Service Dogs for America and asked her if she would help us pay it forward to our veterans. And the way that we're going to do that is with a purse exchange. We also have a bunch of incredible silent auctions, but the purse exchange is really the main event, I would call it, where you give what you get. So if you get bring three purses, you get three purses. So that's kind of the paying it forward part.
Now, one thing about the purse exchange is that every purse that's in the purse exchange is gently used.
In the exchange.
In the exchange part of it. Now, on our silent auction, we have all brand new purses.
Ah.
Designer purses, yes, as well.
So thank you for reminding me of that. We have, one example is out there in the hall, we have a bunch of Prada purses that were sent to us brand new from San Diego, Dooney and Burke.
Yep.
So, yeah.
Wonderful. It's a great concept. Have you heard of a purse exchange before?
Yes. About 4 years ago, I attended a purse exchange with Temple Baptist Church, and that really kind of led me to the idea. I had a great time, so I thought, well, I know a lot of ladies and people like accessories, so what a better opportunity to get a bunch of people together to have a good time. Mm-hmm. So that's really what led me to it. I contacted Doris that had held the event in the past, and she kind of guided me to the direction. I don't think anybody had an idea how big it was going to grow, though.
Well, let's talk about how big it grew.
Shelley. Let me tell you, it grew.
Well, yes. All I know is that my VIP ticket says 75.
Well, let me tell you, we're selling 200 tickets, and VIP is sold out. So you're lucky you got VIP when you did.
I know.
Yes.
I thank you. I can't thank you enough for making this special trip.
So what's VIP?
VIP means you get to get into the exchange part of the event 5 minutes before the rest of the group, which means if you see a special purse you want up there, you get first dibs.
But you can't touch it until the time is near. and they announce that the purse auction is open?
All the purse, the purse exchange part will be roped off. There's an entrance and an exit. So if you bring two purses to the door when you come to the event, then we'll be taking those purses from you and entering them into the exchange. So not only the base of purses that we've started with, but also as people come to the event, they'll be bringing additional purses. So we don't know what other great purses people are going to bring. We're pretty excited about that as well.
That's fantastic. So let's talk about where it's this Saturday.
Sunday at Quality Inn and Suites. It's from 2 to 6. Mm-hmm. There's champagne being served.
Well, and of course, you do know why I decided to buy the tickets. It was because there are hors d'oeuvres. I mean,
oh, there's hors d'oeuvres from almost every restaurant.
I know. I'm just amazed. So thrilled.
We are, and we want to thank our wonderful sponsors.
We've had incredible sponsors. We are already halfway to our goal, and we have not held the event yet. Mm-hmm. I could just do the happy dance. I'm ecstatic. I'd like to thank a few of our sponsors.
Please do.
Our John Deere Implement has been a briefcase sponsor for us, which is our number one
major sponsorship.
Thank you, Shelley. Mm-hmm. And then we also have Dakota Bank and the Ann Carlson Center and Service Dogs for America, our community partnership. Also Lutheran Brotherhood and Dakota Plains, Wilhelm Chevrolet here in town, and John Deere Seating Group. I have two other people on my team. They are both from Valley City. Nathan works for John Deere Seating, and then also Crystal, who works for Dakota Bank. We have Cedar Pass and Creative and Unison Bank as some of our sponsors, Dectel, Edgley Veterinarian Service, and North Hill Bumper and Accessories. Our location was also 100% sponsored. Cork and Barrel will be serving champagne as our beverage sponsorship.
And who's the other sponsorship?
And Valley City Sales Budweiser is...
They've got a really cool new beer. It's Stella Cider.
Cider, yep.
And they're giving away the glasses that you have to drink
glasses.
The cider in.
Oh, yeah.
So it's a small little goblet that's
great
for that yummy, yummy beer. I even took it home and I like it. So it's great.
Okay.
And we have just about every... restaurant in town that is doing hors d'oeuvres.
We brought for both of you girls.
And you knew this was going to happen.
There we go. Mm-hmm. It's white chocolate strawberries and then kind of a little truffle.
Oh,
go ahead and pass that. These are just some of the things
you
get.
Some of the small samples that we have.
And they're good.
They are good. Mm-hmm. I can't eat mine yet, but here you go, Mayor. I'll give you.
Oh, I need my truffle.
Don't say no to the truffles. Trust
there you
me.
Go.
But no, you don't have to. I can trade. I can. Oh, look. She took a bite already. So I can trade with her. Jiminy Christmas.
Because lick it and claim it.
If you don't have fun with purses, you can have fun with chocolate, right?
Exactly.
This is just a small example of some of the wonderful treats we're going to have. We have a chocolatier that's making specialty chocolates, mm-hmm. as well as Buffalo City Grill.
Well, we got to talk real quick about, we know when it is. And it's sold out, so they can't even buy tickets.
No, we have general admission.
Okay, and how
we
much is that?
$20.
Yep.
We do have some general admission tickets still available.
And how do they get one of those?
They can contact me at 320-5034 or Shelley Nanica at
658-0330.
Fantastic. And if there are any left, they can get them at the door. Yes?
We might do that.
Yeah.
We'll see if there are any left.
Lots of silent auctions. We have over 30 items for
Fantastic.
The silent auctions. So thank you for having us on.
Thank
we
you
really
for being here. I really appreciate you coming.
Huh? Mary, you need to come too.
Okay. I do love purses. So.
And you do love chocolate.
And I love chocolate, so
go.
We're good.
Strawberries, yes. Yeah. Okay. Couple quick questions while we're waiting here for our next guest. Is the Metro Plains townhouses area zoned for that type of residence? And when will the project start?
I guess I actually don't know the answer to either of those questions off the top of my head. I believe there's a commercial zoning on that property, which should also include all the classifications from the zoning below it, which would be the multifamily residential. So we shouldn't have any anticipated problems with zoning, but I guess I don't have the map in front of me to confirm it for sure. And I believe the project wants to start after they have secured all their financing, and I'm not sure they know that start date yet on that project either, so more news to come on those ones.
Okay, because zoning usually works, whatever it is, you can have anything more than that. I mean, for instance, you can put a single-family dwelling, if you want to, in a commercial zoning.
Actually, I don't think single families are allowed in commercial, but usually what each zoning, so it's kind of tiered. So start with, like, single-family residential, and then you move up to, say, like, R2A, which allows up to 6 to 12 units on multifamily, but they'll also say, and all the classifications of the zoning class of, and then it'll say the one immediately below them. So usually they do contain a zoning classification of everything that was one class below it as well. And so at least one class, maybe more. So I don't anticipate any problems there.
Okay. Our next guests are Elaine Hagland and Deb Gletney, who are here to talk about the United Methodist Church After School Program. Thank you guys for coming.
Thank you for having us.
So what is the After School Program?
Well, the After School Program started the first week in January, the very first Wednesday. It is every Wednesday, and it is for kids that are in 6th through 8th grade. It's a youth program for those individuals in that grade, those grades.
And we knew that the Youth for Christ had programming for students Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, Friday, but not on Wednesdays. And so we felt that there would be a need on Wednesdays for those children to come over.
Okay.
And the main thing with that is that we really wanted to have a place for that age group to come over, and it's a safe, kind of a fun environment, but then they're still supervised when they're there. So.
Okay. How much does this cost?
Doesn't cost a dime.
Oh.
It's absolutely free to the students who come. As a matter of fact, last Wednesday was a professional development day for the staff. The teaching staff and school got out at 1. So the students came over grades 6 through 8 at 1 o'clock, and they went bowling until 3 when the program normally starts, and then they did their regular programs from 3 until 5.
Okay.
So, and they didn't pay a dime for bowling either. So it doesn't cost them a thing or their parents.
Fantastic. What happens on that wasn't a typical Wednesday afternoon.
No.
So how does it typically run?
So a typical day is they come over at 3:10 after their after their classes, and then usually we from 3:15 on till about 3:30 they have a snack. And oh my, the snacks have been absolutely wonderful. In fact, they talk about that. They talk about the snacks being the food is awesome. And so, and then from 3:30 until 4:15, we've had many people donate, like different table games and different types of games. And so then there's kind of a game time, and they can socialize with their friends. Also, going back to the snack time, that's always been a real important thing, that they're able to kind of text or use their cell phones at that time. So just during that time, we've agreed that maybe that would be the time that they can use their technology, and then after that, maybe we can kind of spend the time socializing and visiting. After that, from 4:15 to 4:30, they have kind of a topic time. And
the topic time is relevant to some current issues that are going on. Right now, we're talking about pondering, and we're talking about just thinking over some different situations and issues. You know, things like having a positive attitude. When it was Martin Luther King Day, we talked about, you know, service to others and that sort of thing. So it changes each week. There's no preparation for it at all. The kids just need to come with an opinion and a thought. So the topic times are relevant to them.
How do middle school kids get involved with this?
All they have to do is they can walk by after school, and many of them do, on the way to the library. Mm-hmm. You'll see kids kind of hanging out in that area or just right in front of the church because it's right next door. And they're welcome to come in one or two times. After that, we ask that they do have permission slips signed by their parents. So the first couple of times, if they want to come and just check it out and see what it's like and what it's all about. And of course, their friends. You know, many of the kids have been bringing their own friends, and that's been pretty fun to see.
Good.
And also in that schedule, after snack time, game time, and topic time is a homework time. And the homework time is roughly 4:30 to 5. It's about a half an hour. And we're pretty firm with that if they don't have homework, they need to bring something to read, or we have reading material for them or something. We don't want to take away from their homework time. We don't want them to go home and have homework because they've come to the after school program. So it's very important that they have something to do during that quiet time
for that last half hour.
How many kids have been coming? I mean, it just started, what, a week, 2 weeks
right.
ago?
Yes. I think the bowling day, the bowling day, we had 17. But I think we're running anywhere from mm-hmm. 10 to 12. Very heavy on the boys. A lot more boys than girls. And so we would just love to have any more come.
Okay. Yes. What I want to end with, really, is I want to end with your motto at your church, because I think it's wonderful.
Mm-hmm. Our motto is open hearts, open minds, open doors, and we feel that that's exactly what we're doing. We felt that there was a need for this. We've molded over for a long time and thought it was just time to jump in and do it, so our doors are open. We would love to have any of the youth, grades 6 through 8, come and check us out.
And if any parents have any questions, they can call you or the church office?
They can call the church office, 952-3718.
And this is the United Methodist Church, which is the one right downtown, right next to the library.
Exactly. They just walk across the street.
Yes, and we'd encourage parents to come and spend the time with us, too, just so
check
they
it
can
out.
See what it's
okay.
like.
Yes. Yes. Mm-hmm.
Well, thank you both for coming.
Thank you.
We get more kids.
Thank you
very
much.
Okay. Thank you for having us.
All right, Mayor Anderson, how much extra will the fancy paint job cost?
I think the estimate is $44,000 for the change order for the paint job to go from the simple paint job that was approved in the original project to this fancy one. The paint job is estimated to last about 20 years, maybe a little bit more, because the technology for paint has gotten a lot better, and so the paint should last longer and look nice longer. And so really it comes out to about $1,500 a year, something like that would be the extra additional cost.
Okay, so one other real quick question about that.
Mm-hmm.
What fund does that actually come out of?
Well, it would be part of the water tower project itself, which is being bonded out of the city's infrastructure fund, which is funded by 0.5% sales tax.
So I guess what I wanted to make sure I understood was that this isn't coming out of something that would be used for some other
Right.
For
this
snow
is,
removal, for
right,
instance.
Right. This would not be take away from the city's general fund, actually, nor does it affect property taxes in any way, because this is funded completely out of 0.5% sales tax. And you should know that your water utility itself is not dependent on property taxes or the general fund either. It's based on user fees. So actually, virtually nothing with the water utility is related to your property taxes.
Okay, great.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much. We will be right back. I think it's time for our break, and I think Wayne's got some news for us. Wayne? Welcome back. I'm really sorry. We've just been sort of teasing here with Rick Wallentine, who's our next guest, talking about the performing arts series that continues at Jamestown University of Jamestown. Hey, I stopped myself.
I know,
I'm getting
that's
better.
Okay. That's okay. I do it too.
Okay. Rick, let's talk about what's coming up.
So we have our third event of the season. We have a cabaret show called I Hear Music. And our guests are Ann Christofferson, who is a professor up at UND. She spent a couple years in New York City perfecting this act of hers, and I've heard her do a little bit of it. It is absolutely fantastic. And a good friend of hers, Zach Redler, is coming. Zach is an accompanist and a vocal coach in New York City, and is also a composer and pianist, and so he's going to be playing for her. So it's going to be a fantastic show.
And how on earth did you get Anne to come?
I called her up and I said, "Ann, do you want to come?" And she said, "Sure."
Wow.
she's a good friend of mine, and we do try to do a mix of out-of-state talent and in-state talent. And so Ann is one of our in-state talents, obviously, and we have a plethora of talent here in North Dakota. So,
what's very nice about this particular show is that it's on a Friday night.
It is,
and it's the perfect date night. So let's talk about that.
Well, we thought of that as we tried to, line them up for a particular night, and she said, "Well, I could do Valentine's Day," and we thought that would be a lot of fun. And Bob Adele said, "Well, we have to do a dinner," and I said, "All right, let's do a dinner." So we have a special Valentine's dinner that we are catering before the show. So everybody's going to be on stage. We're going to set up the stage of Ryland just like a cabaret, a nightclub, and we're going to serve dinner, $25 a person. And you have a choice of...
Well, hey, I was going to say, you're on my show, and we got to talk about what the food is, not
all
of the entertainment.
And I understand you have a passion for desserts, and I won't be able to tell you what the dessert is. I can only promise it is so decadent.
It's Valentine's Day, it darn well better be chocolate.
I know.
Okay.
And I'm going to have a dessert tasting this Thursday, so I'm very excited about that.
And where are we having this?
We are having this...
And what time?
Up at school at 1 o'clock.
And you're welcome
to come, and I'll let you taste. The dinner is $25. It's actually a pretty good bargain. You won't be able to get reservations at the grill because, you know, people have been reserving. Let's face it, guys make reservations months and months in advance. Yeah, right. But you'll have a choice of a Zinfandel chicken, which is a really nice dish with some spinach risotto, or a pesto tortellini. With some grilled vegetables go along with that. We're serving wine, of course. There'll be champagne with dessert, which, as I mentioned, is particularly decadent. And then that'll be at 6 o'clock, and then the show starts at 7:30.
How embarrassed do you think I'll be at 1 o'clock this Thursday as I'm wandering around campus going, Rick,
where are you? Come to the cafeteria. Aramark is catering. And we're very excited because we have a new head chef manager of Aramark, and he's a fantastic chef. And a really great guy. So we're very excited about the things that he's doing up there for us.
All right, so now let's talk about the tickets and how people can actually get them and how many you're selling.
We are selling as many as we can, of course. We have our members, and we're very grateful to those folks who purchase season tickets. So if you have a season ticket, you have a space. Dinner is extra, and you have to call the box office up at the university, I almost said college, to reserve dinner as well, and you pay for that separately. Tickets are $15. If you don't already have a ticket, and dinner is $25 a person. The number is 252-3467, and the box office is 5435, I believe. Or you can email tickets@uj.edu.
That sounds great.
It's going to be a lot of fun.
The other shows have been, I've heard, wonderful.
We've had a very, very nice season. We had a very interesting and unique group of ladies in from Oregon in the fall, a trumpet organist and a vocalist. That was fantastic. That was in the chapel. And just a couple weeks ago, we had the NDSU Brass Quintet here, and a fantastic audience, big audience, and they put on a great show. So we had a really good time.
And this will be another great show.
It will. We're looking forward to it.
Okay. So again, it's Valentine's night. The show starts at 7:30. What time does dinner start?
Dinner starts at 6.
Okay. And is it going to be limited? Because you really do have limited space.
We do have limited space
on
the
stage.
It is a big stage. I'm pretty confident we can get 90 to 100 people on stage.
So I
think we should have plenty of room.
Okay. Good. Well, thank you, Rick, for coming.
Thanks for having me.
I really
appreciate it.
And you just may see me wandering around campus on
That's fine. Give me a call. I'll let you taste the dessert.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, we've got another question here for you, Mayor. Are police ticketing cars that are not removed for snow removal? Hold on, let me finish. Disabled individuals have a difficult time parking when their cars are blocked in.
The police are not ticketing it. Our ordinance does allow for them if myself or when the council's in session declares a snow emergency, then we can enforce the ticketing in the snow emergency routes. So they do have the authority to do that. I have never declared an emergency, nor do I think one's ever been declared in the time that that ordinance has been in place. We do try to do it on the proactive side rather than on the punishing or reactive ticketing side, is that we try to provide the public service announcements for when that plowing is going to happen in the various areas so that people can move their vehicles. And it is truly inconvenient for anybody to get their vehicle plowed in by the snow. So it is something that you just need to look at your public service announcements to kind of understand the schedule. And in general, we begin the residential areas at 11 a.m. following the snowstorm, and then the downtown areas at 11 p.m. So if you kind of think about when the snow ends after an event, that's typically the schedule that they'll base their public service announcements on.
Okay. Our next guest is Joan Enderle. Hi, Joan.
Oh, good evening.
How are you?
I'm great.
Haven't seen you for a while. I'm glad you're back. I like your new glasses.
Thanks.
Let's talk about Giving Hearts Day.
Well, yes. The American Heart Association, along with other area charities or nonprofits, is really excited to let the Jamestown community and area know about Giving Hearts Day. And It's we're watching the clock because it's a 24-hour online giving opportunity. And the wonderful thing is all donations are matched. So it's a way for you to double your impact.
How on earth is everything matched?
Well, Dakota Medical Foundation and the Impact Foundation really wants to support nonprofits. And so they actually started this in 2008. And they've expanded it. And matter of fact, last year there was $3.7 million given in that 24-hour period of time by almost 17,000 people. And that was helped support 179 charities. And so this year they've expanded that, and the American Heart Association is just one of those groups that has been added, along with the Arts Center. And how it works is that previous to Giving Hearts Day, organizations have actually found generous donors who have been willing to provide the match.
Oh,
plus Dakota okay. Medical Foundation provides the match. So for instance, they were providing organizations like the American Heart Association up to $4,000 match. And then we found another $3,500 of donors who were willing to serve as a match. So maybe not quite everything gets matched, but quite a bit gets matched. So that's a great opportunity. And the nice thing about it is that you just need to donate $10 or more, and you can donate to one or a number of organizations from the list. You have to apply and be selected. There are also organizations from Minot, Bismarck.
No, real quick. The person who's giving doesn't have to apply and be selected.
No, correct. I'm sorry.
I just wanted to make
the organizations.
Clear.
Right. Yep. Okay. So all what you do is on February 13th. So that's you got to mark your calendar because.
So this is Thursday. We've got. I mean, Friday we've got something. Saturday we've got something. Sunday we've got something. The next week we've got. You know, things going on, this is Thursday, then we've got dinner on Friday and
right.
singing.
So the nice thing about this is no matter how cold it is, you mm-hmm. don't have to leave your house.
Okay, so tell us exactly how it works.
Okay, so on February 13th, Thursday, February 13th, for 24 hours, so starting at 12:01 till midnight, you go online and you go to impactgiveback.org. And you click on donate, and it takes only a couple minutes. You select the organization or organizations you want to donate to, the amount you want to donate to each, and then, of course, a payment type, and click send, and you then have made a donation, which, like I said, will be matched.
So the nice thing about this is not only are you giving to whomever it is you choose to give to.
Correct.
That's on this list. But then your donation is matched.
Yes.
And you don't have to go outside.
And you don't have to go outside. And the way the weather's been, yeah, you don't have to go outside. You get to, and you, the nice thing is also, it's on February 13th. Because the other part of this is you can make a donation in memory of someone or in honor of someone, and it gives you the opportunity to have send them an email e-card letting them know that you were thinking about them and that you have made a donation to a great nonprofit. And so it's really kind of a fun thing and
Fantastic.
An easy thing to do. So kind of a way to almost send a Valentine's card and make a difference not only in the lives of other people.
Great. Okay. Again, there's nothing you can do except wait till the 13th, go online to impactgiveback.org. And it's pretty simple to remember. And if you have any questions, call Joan.
Yep. And if
and we'll also have a link to Impact Give Back on our website, CSI News Now.
Right. And they're tax deductible. And there's just a couple, if for people who don't have a computer at home, you have to go out, but on February 13th, we have some sites that will be open, like Plantation Coffee is anyone who goes to Plantation Coffee, and they'll have a setup and a computer. They'll give you a discount on your drink if you make a donation to any organization
Great.
That day. So,
super. Thank you, Joan. Thanks for coming.
Thanks.
Okay. Now, while we wait for our next guest, I'm going to ask you to talk
yes.
about Menards.
Yeah, let's talk about Menards. I've been so well trained to say Big Box Home Improvement Store. I'm so excited that I don't have to say that anymore, that we can say the actual name. If We've talked about kind of the process that we've gone through, and last Tuesday the City Council had a meeting in which we entered into a purchase and sale agreement with Menards. And what this does is start the clock ticking on the many things that they have to check on and get prepared for in order to be committed to the City of Jamestown with Menards. This is a full-size Menards. In fact, it's the latest and greatest style, so it's not a small scale or any other version of Menards than the latest and greatest model, all the same product lines and all the same pricing as our region. They are looking at locating just south of I-94, just west of the Buffalo Mall, on the parcel that takes about 20 acres for their development. They are going to be putting in all of the infrastructure. They're going to be grading the entire site, upgrading the roads that lead to that property, which is 10th Avenue going north and 23rd Street going to the west edge of their property. Connecting to water and sewer, any other infrastructure they have to do. And when they do that, they're going to put the money in up front, and then they would be rebated up to the cost of that infrastructure improvement with a 0.5% sales tax for up to 25 years. If they have lower sales years, they will and are not fully reimbursed after 25 years, they're just out those costs. And if they have higher sales years and they are able to recover the cost of the infrastructure, which is estimated at $2.4 million, within a shorter period of time than 25 years, then the sales tax simply would not be rebated to them after that's completed. We're also contemplating this tax increment finance district for this as well to cover the city's costs and the land acquisition on this project. And so that would be a property tax increment on what they put on for improvements, which is estimated to be about an $8 to $10 million building. And we would capture those property taxes for up to 15 years until that bond is paid for, as well as 0.5% sales tax just from their store. And I should be very clear about that. Only the property taxes are being captured just from their development, and only the sales taxes are being captured from their development. And they're responsible for the financing of all the infrastructure in order to make that happen. And some people have asked about, you know, a risk. What if they leave? What if they close? What if they're bought out? Those kinds of concerns out there. And because they're the financing mechanism on the infrastructure, if they leave, they don't get paid back. So they have a lot of skin in the game in this particular situation. And we have a lot of work to do yet to make sure that this can happen. So I don't want anyone to misinterpret the fact that this is a fully committed project, because there's a lot of work to do. We're just happy that we can talk about that work now outside of the confidential arena. And so this is 180 days of work to do now, and we have to come up with that tax increment finance district. We have to go through all the proceedings to create that. Same thing with the sales tax rebate agreement and the regular developers agreement and all of the civil engineering plans that are required for the development of that area. So it's, I think, a very positive thing for our community to finally see a retail catalyst. And I really think that's what a Menards is they're a catalyst for the other development to happen around them. And I can feel very comfortable about doing this type of incentive package for a business that is going to be capturing dollars that are currently lost out of our community. I've talked about before on this show the leakage study that was done that compared us to other markets that are very similar to us in demographics. And really, they were capturing an incredible amount of sales tax dollars into their community through the home improvement sector, and we were not. And I think it, whether you have a quantitative analysis in the form of a leakage study or of a qualitative analysis, is that you just think, how many times have I gone to Menards to purchase home improvement goods, and how many people did I know from Jamestown at that store when I went there? I think we know that there's some pretty significant leakage. We're not trying to do this to harm any business or any competitor in Jamestown, because they're honestly already competing with these businesses, and just not in Jamestown. And Jamestown loses out because of that. We lose out on the revenue. We lose out on that turnover of dollars here. And so we're looking for a fair playing field now for all the competition once this project comes in.
Okay, one more real quick question before we get to Nelly, and that is, why was 3rd Avenue Northwest by the elevator being closed for so many months?
3rd Avenue Northwest by the elevator.
It's right here.
Oh, right over here? I guess I don't. Oh, well, just with the project. Oh, the Quiet Zone permanently closed it. Oh, that's the exit.
That's the one they're talking
about. Oh, I'm sorry. No, it wasn't orientated. That crossing is closed permanently. It was part of the negotiations of the Quiet Zone, is that we would close that crossing in order for us to be able to accommodate the other Quiet Zone crossings. If we had not closed that, we would have had to provide the Quiet Zone in that area as well, and all the accommodations, and it would have been incredibly expensive, and plus would have taken additional negotiations with the railroad. So that did happen before I was mayor, so I'm not 100% sure on all the negotiation agreements that happened with the Quiet Zone, but that is, it's not going to be reopened.
Okay. My next guests are Nellie Deegan and Kayla Esslinger, right?
That's right.
Okay, and they're going to be talking about the Parent Awareness Prevention Center.
Thank you. Thank you for having us on your show
today.
Thank
you so much, Nellie. Yeah. Thank you for coming too, Kayla.
Well, we wanted to share with the public and thank the public. I'm going to put this up so you can kind of zoom in, hopefully. Mm-hmm. We just completed a study, 3-year study, and this is about setting up parent centers throughout our whole state. Kayla and I have, in the last 3 years, attended a lot of various workshops, seminars, and the concerns that parents have, students have, and also administrators. Things that young people, sadly to say, become victims, you know, of different circumstances. And our elements today in our society nationwide is, you know, drugs, bullying, suicide, you know, a lot of negative activity. We have wonderful kids in our community and throughout our state, but they're vulnerable. And parents are also asking, you know, we need this help. And so when we developed this parent center 3 years ago, the goal and objective was to have Jamestown become the role model for the state. And so as even Mayor Katie Anderson was there at our opening and with her proclamation, and we're very grateful for that. Also at the same time, you know, when we did the study, all these things, these obstacles came about. And we have great people in the educational arena. There's no question about that. But sometimes we have to put ourselves in their position. When we hire a professional, their job description is whatever. And now we're getting to our society that we're asking them to do 50 more things. Or, you know, sometimes it's very difficult for them. So the Parent Center was a catalyst to be able to bridge that and to be able to communicate. And so when people were comfortable, we would always say, well, you have to go back and, you know, guide them in the proper format. And so when they were comfortable with that, then we were able to address the concerns. And the only people that we addressed it to was the superintendent, past as well as present, and the president of the school board, because of confidentiality. We had to respect that, as it should be. So now with our study, we're now taking it further. We sent it to the Commander-in-Chief, President Obama, Department of Education in Washington, D.C., the congressional delegation at our state level, also our Department of Public Instruction here in North Dakota, Bismarck, also the North Dakota Board of Association. And also we've sent those to our legislators and in the Civil Rights Office. Because what is happening throughout our state, when I've spoken to people at a state level, they said, Nellie, the concerns that you're addressing in this study is happening to us throughout the state. It's not just because we're in Jamestown, it's everywhere. So we've now proposed, because Kayla and I have volunteered, and 3 years, and the goal was when we started this, I gave my professional services as a volunteer so we could establish it. And then when we were finished with the study, we would propose that they get funding. And so our district is in a catch-22 now because they have no funding and they're going to cut back. And that's understandable. So my mission now is to go at all levels of government to make sure not only this district gets that resources, but other districts in this state. And so this evening, if there's any persons or corporations, where was that lady when prior to us? Hey, come back. No.
Impact, give back.
Yeah. Yes. You know, we can utilize those resources because there's a lot of corporations, a lot of companies that'd be more than happy to partner in with the educational arena. This is not a nonprofit organization. It would be a tax deductible. It could go, you know, because we've had funding sent to the Parent Center to help the families. And so that is part of the system. You know, and when I came from another state, we had parent centers established, and it was funded through Title I grants, federal funding, and tax dollars, you know, and that was part of the system.
The system, you mean part of the school district?
Part of the school district. It's not an outside entity, and we don't want people to ever think that it was, because it wasn't. We're not a nonprofit. But if we don't take that step to help our children and our community, this is a healthy and safe environment. And we have helped a lot of families. And in return, it has been a safe environment also for our educational system. So anyways, we wanted to say thanks to all the people that have came forward, because I'll give you one example. Sanford Clinic here in Jamestown, we had a concern, parents had concerns because of type 1 diabetes. And this is throughout our whole state and all over our nation. So I went all over the place trying to get that resource. Well, we were very fortunate. We got someone to come in from Sanford Clinic, and they're doing the training so they can be in compliance and at the same time educate those in case of an emergency. And prior to that, that wasn't there. Mm-hmm. So we've channeled a lot of the resources, because when people are in Catch-22, they go, I can't look in the Yellow Pages, where do I go? And sometimes it's very difficult for families or anyone, even students or even teachers, to say, you know, we need help, or what is the resource for us? So anyways, Kayla wants to share this.
I was just going to say, Kayla, what? Yeah. You had something you wanted to share?
Yes.
Yeah, I'm waiting until Nellie's finished.
Okay.
We had lots of people. We would have monthly meetings. And we had lots of people that volunteered their time and came and did presentations for us. Mr. Toso came, superintendent of Jamestown Public Schools at the time, came and did a in-service for us and told us the standards of where volunteer people should be and things like that, and school policies and state policies. We had our ribbon cutting ceremony, and Mayor Anderson was there and did a city proclamation for us. We had Mary Weiler from the North Dakota Suicide Foundation come and visit with us, and then we incorporated the Out of Darkness Walk later in the year in September for that. Christina Rittenbach from the NDSU Extension Office here in Jamestown, Stutzman County Extension Office, came and did a presentation. That was really good. It was on social networking 1 month, and then another month it was sexting and texting. So we had Teague Kinsler there from South Central Human Services. He's a licensed counselor, and that was on, it was really an eye-opener for us, all the different drugs that are available to students nowadays, every age group. So it was a really informational for the parents to see what was available. Russ Sunderland from the Department of Human Services has been to a couple of our meetings, and Mary Thyschel from the Sexual Assault Services Coordinator from town came, and Beth DeWald from American Red Cross, and she helped us on emergency preparedness, and Officer Nicole Anderson came 1 month and did a great presentation on self-defense, and we kind of incorporated that with the seniors leaving the small community mm-hmm. of Jamestown and going to a college. So that was another good thing. We've had really good support.
You've had wonderful support.
Yeah. Yes.
And so now your focus is what? You want to...
Now we're...
You're looking for funding.
Yes.
And but it's not the kind of funding that you can get a tax write-off for, because you're not a nonprofit.
No, but see, the funding would go to the school district and designate it to that pocket.
I see.
And like in the past, where we have had funding, it goes to the school district earmarked for the parent awareness. So it is a tax deduction, but it goes through the school
I
system.
I see.
It is not going to us.
I got it.
So,
okay.
And so anybody out there that wants to donate...
If anybody has any questions, Kayla, who should they contact?
They can contact me at 320-3302. Or Nellie.
They can contact me 320-5440. And I think everyone has my number.
But you know that tattoo on your forehead is a dead giveaway.
Yeah, there you go. And but we are going to pursue it at the state level, because legislation is changing in the year 2015, and my understanding is they're going to be focusing on a lot of intervention prevention. So this study is
great.
Going to be able
Super.
To help our whole state. So great. We want to thank you and everyone that Kayla has shared with, and all the volunteers that have come forward to help us help our community. So
thank you very much, Nellie. Thank you so much, Kayla, for coming.
Thank you.
And we'll just make sure that everybody knows that you know, if they have any questions, they can give you a call.
Yes. Perfect. Absolutely. Thank you.
Okay, I got another question for you, Mayor. Are you ready?
Okay. I'm ready.
Has Mayor Anderson decided if she is running for re-election this year? And which city council seats are up for election this year?
I did take out a petition for running for re-election, so I guess that news is
out there now. I haven't really began getting my signatures or anything yet, so I suppose I haven't made a very big commitment to running until I actually get that completed. And the only other council member that is up is Councilman Gumke, and he has also taken out a petition to run for re-election. I think he's beating me on the signatures too, so I better get on the ball a little bit with that. So we will have those two seats are up, and remember that city council elections happen with the primaries in June, but they are a final election for city members.
Okay. Good. Thank you so much for coming.
You're welcome.
I really appreciate it, and we will see you again in March.
Yes.
I'm gonna don't forget to finish your truffle there.
I gotta get my treats.
Thank you all for watching, and we appreciate your viewing. Make sure you stay safe this month, stay in from the cold, and thanks for watching.